Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for a late Ontario evening on the topic of how circulation patterns affect water quality along the Toronto waterfront. My name is Don Little, and I'm the Acting Program Manager for the Toronto and Region Remedial Action Plan, which hosts these events. So Lake Ontario evenings such as this, they're part of a speaker series, and they take place typically 3 to 4 times a year, always on a variety of different topics related to the Toronto waterfront or Lake Ontario or the Great Lakes. So this is our agenda for this evening. So as you can see, we've got a great lineup of speakers and presenters for tonight. But before we get into those, my co-facilitator, Tisha Tan, who is a community learning coordinator at Toronto Region Conservation Authority, will start us off with some housekeeping, followed by a land acknowledgement.
Okay, great. Thanks so much, Don. Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. So just a few housekeeping notes before we start. If you are joining our webinar by phone, then you are able to swipe between the webcam view and slide view just by swiping right on your screen there. Sometimes folks who are joining through a mobile device may experience difficulties or not understand why they're seeing one view over the other. So it's just a matter of swiping on your device. Everyone who is in the audience today has been muted to limit background noise. But that doesn't mean that we don't want to hear from you. We have a lineup of really great speakers this evening. And so if you have a question for a speaker, then what you can do is enter it into the Q&A box or the Q&A panel found on the bottom of your screen. We will address questions sort of at the end of the program. We also have a chat function as well. And if you address your chats to myself, if you're experiencing technical issues, or contact me via email if you're having technical issues, then I can help you out that way. And then finally, this webinar is being recorded, and the recording will be available on the Toronto and Region Remedial Action Plan website a few days after this live presentation. And we'll share a follow-up email to let you know where you can find the recording online. So we'd like to begin the event with a land acknowledgement. Although we find ourselves geographically dispersed today, meeting here in this online environment, I'd like to begin by recognizing that we all work, live, and gather on traditional Indigenous territory. We respectfully acknowledge that the lands that we are situated on are traditional territories and treaty lands, especially in particular, those of the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabe of the Williams Treaty First Nations, the Huron-Wendat, the Haudenosaunee, and are now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people. Through our work with land and water resources within the Greater Toronto Region, TRC appreciates and respects the history and diversity of the land, and we're grateful to have the opportunity to work and meet in this territory. So we invite you to acknowledge the territories and treaty lands in your local area, and we encourage you to explore the interactive map at native-land.ca if you want to learn more about those Indigenous groups. And we'll throw it back over to you, John. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, thanks, Tisha. If you've ever been to these events before, you'll know that we like to start things off with a couple of poll questions, just to see if folks have attended Lake Ontario evenings before, and also how familiar folks are with the remedial action plan. So, Tisha, if you don't mind bringing up our first poll question, there it is. Okay, so our first question is this your first time attending a Lake Ontario evening? Oh, and I see they're both up there. So the second question is familiar with the Toronto Region Remedial Action Plan. So maybe we'll give about 10 seconds or so for folks to answer those. Okay, so we'll have the poll in about three, to, oh, one, there we go, perfect. Okay, so it looks like we've got a fairly even split between folks who have attending these for the first time, and then also folks who are familiar with remedial action plans. So that's great. So one of the goals of these events is to spread the word about the remedial action plan. So it's great to see some new people. So for our newcomers, I'll provide just a quick introduction to the remedial action plan and how we're working to contribute to a healthier lake in Toronto Waterfront.
Sorry, John, I'm just going to jump in a little bit and just say that things are a little bit slow coming from you. So maybe if you, oh, and we've just lost him. Hey, Don, are you back?
Yeah, sorry, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. Maybe just turn off your camera while you're sharing your screen just to help with the connection. Okay. Awesome. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, sorry about that. So the Toronto Region Remedial Action Plan came out of a process that started in the late 1980s when Toronto was identified by the International Joint Commission on the Great Lakes as one of 42 areas of concern in Canada and the U.S. So the slide here says 43, but that's because an additional AOC was added in the 90s. So areas of concern were identified. Oh.
Sorry, Dad, I'll jump in again. I can't see your slides.
You can't see the slide. Okay, sorry, no. 1 second. Sorry, everyone. Try something else here. I'm going to try to connect to a different source here. So let me know, Tisha, maybe when you can see my slide again.
Okay, will do.
Okay, sorry, everybody. Okay, is it any luck, Tisha?
No, I don't see anything yet. Let me see if I can open them on my end and then maybe we can go that way.
Okay. Just on a few different things here. Can you see my slides now?
Yes, we can see them. Your voice was a little choppy, but we'll see if that works.
Okay. All right. Okay. Sorry, everybody. So I'll start from the beginning of this slide. So the Toronto Region Remedial Action Plan came out of a process that started in the late 1980s when Toronto was identified by the International Joint Commission on the Great Lakes as two areas of concern in Canada and the U.S. So this slide, it says 43, but an additional AOC was added in the 90s, and areas of concern were defined as areas where local environmental remediation posed a threat to the Great Lakes at large. So each of these areas of concern was measured up against 14 potential uses that could be potential use permits. And in Toronto, 11 of 14 were attributed, and originally 8 of these were deemed impaired and 3 were further assessment, as you can see on this slide here. So the goal of the remedial action plan is to address these impairments and ultimately delist Toronto as an area of concern. So the remedial action plan, or also called the RAP, is a unique plan for each AOC, which identifies projects that have been or are to be implemented by RAP partners in order to address each of the remaining impairments. So in Toronto, we made great progress in the last 30 years by working with partners to implement projects that improve water quality, habitat and populations. And as a result, 5 of the original beneficial uses are no longer impaired and progress has been made on the remaining 6. So many actions have been implemented over the last 30 years, but as this Lake Ontario Evening focuses on water quality, I just wanted to highlight a few examples pertaining to a topic. So one of which is includes aesthetics. So on July 10th of 2020, this BUI was redesignated to not impaired. And the information which drove the redesignation of this BUI came largely from a multi-year aesthetic monitoring program along the waterfront and within the watersheds, which showed that of over 1,600 observations made, 94% found aesthetic conditions to be either excellent or good. And 80% of all observations indicated water quality that was clear, colorless, and odorless. And even though this BUI has been redesignated, there continues to be a lot of great work along the waterfront to help improve aesthetics, particularly related to cleaning up floatables. And shortly, we'll see a presentation by Chelsea Rockman of the University of Toronto's trash tagging program. And thanks to substantial efforts by the city and partners, international certification standards for water quality, beach management, safety, and environmental education through the Blue Flag program. 8 of our 11 beaches in Toronto are Blue Flag certified. So some of the efforts the city and partners have undertaken to reduce E. coli have been implemented through components of the Don River Central Waterfront combined sewer overflow systems, such as the Wet Weather Flow Master Plan. So these efforts also help address other BUIs like eutrophication. So eutrophication is a process where a body of water becomes enriched with nutrients such as phosphates, which can then lead to excess plant and algae growth. So along the waterfront, phosphorus levels have significantly declined since the 1970s. However, rainstorm events continue to discharge large amounts of runoff into our rivers and streams, which can lead to eutrophication, but as many efforts to address water quality issues such as these continue through the flow master plan. So that concludes my introduction to the wrap, but if you would like to learn more about our projects or you would like to view our work plan and how we plan on delisting, you can visit our website at torontowrap.ca. Follow us on Twitter at @wrap_Toronto, or you can email me directly using the address on screen. So without further ado, we'll get into our talks for tonight. So our first speaker is Chelsea Rockman. So I will stop sharing my screen here. So Chelsea is an assistant professor in ecology at University and co-founder of the U of T trash team. Chelsea received her PhD in ecology from UC Davis and San Diego State University. And in addition to her research, Chelsea routinely advises governments on policies related to plastic pollution. So Chelsea, whenever you are ready, you can share your screen and take it away.
Okay, thank you, Don. Can you see my screen okay and hear me and see me?
Looks good.
Okay, excellent, thank you. Okay, so thanks everybody for being here. I'm going to talk a bit about some of the work actually under the floatable strategy that Don mentioned, which is all about tagging trash on our waterfront. And so here we were using GPS tag bottles basically to understand the fate of floatables and then also to inform mitigation. But before I jump in, I'll introduce our team. So the hat I'm wearing, although I am a professor at U of T, is of the U of T trash team. It's a community-based organization that Rafaela and Susan and myself started in 2017. And we've definitely been working with TRCA in some capacity basically since we began. And our goal is really to use scientific facts as well as really solutions-based research to sort of make positive change around plastic pollution. So our goal is to increase waste literacy through community outreach and education, and then to use science to inform both downstream and upstream solutions. So today I'll focus on our Fighting Floatables project, which is all about tracking and trapping trash on our waterfront in Toronto. Mostly within the Toronto Harbour and then also just outside in the Outer Harbour Marina. There are several projects that are kind of within and under this umbrella, all of which fall under the floatable strategy, which the floatable strategy was started by TRCA, Ports Toronto, U of T trash team, also in collaboration with Swim Drink Fish and also the City of Toronto. So we're trying to do lots of work in the region to help reduce the floatables in our waterfront. As part of our own Fighting Floatables project, we have sort of three projects, which are in collaboration with lots of different groups, as you can see down below. The first one was tracking the trash on our waterfront through visual audit. That was sort of a step one, and I'll talk about what that is. Our next one was trapping trash. So this is with the sea bins that Don mentioned during his talk on the waterfront. This year we have 10 sea bins in the water and 10 litter traps, which are in storm drains on Queens Quay. So I'll talk a little bit about that, but I'll mainly be focusing on the tagging trash project, which was using basically GPS tag bottles to basically follow how the wind and the currents moved this litter around on our waterfront to inform sort of where we can mitigate the pollution and also inform some of the solutions that we can implement based on kind of where we see that litter accumulating. So the tagging trash project was in collaboration with TRCA, Ports Toronto, the Ministry of the Environment, and also Environment and Climate Change Canada. So the first step before, this was kind of one of the first things we did. We thought if we want to put trash traps in the water, so the U of T trash team sort of began around this goal, sort of our centerpiece was to get some sort of trash trapping device in our waterfront. So in the beginning, we were interested in a trash wheel, which would sit at the end of the Don River. And as the water flows down and the litter gets kind of caught in this boom, it would go up through a water wheel into a bin. There's so much construction going on in the Don River, as many of you know, that a trash wheel in the Don River is not currently feasible. So we tried to think about what are the other types of trash trapping devices we could use and where might we put them. So we did a visual audit where we had our students walk around on the waterfront and just simply quantify and characterize the litter that they could see by doing standing surveys and using literally just their eyes. And so here you can see the darker spots and the bigger circles are where you have more of the litter. And many of these places are places where we either have sea bins today or we have plans for sea bins in the future. Peter Basin, as you can see, is insane. We don't have sea bins there yet, but we have students that skim multiple days a week and they could be there for more than an hour. So we have to basically decide on a time and stop there. So that is a site really in need of a trash capture device. So at the moment, we are using sea bins. Like I said, we are also using litter traps this year for the first time. So the litter traps sit in the storm drains all along Queens Quay, and anything that runs off the road goes into these litter traps and collects them and prevents them from going into Lake Ontario. So that's a project with TRCA, the City of Toronto, and us. And then with Ports Toronto, we have multiple sea bins. We started in 2019. This year, we currently have 10 in the water. TRCA and the city have two more for the island, and we'll get those in as soon as we can. But in any case, what these are is they're like these floating garbage bins that sort of sit on the end of a dock. And as the litter comes near it, it sucks it in pretty gently. So it doesn't suck in wildlife or anything like that. But as the litter floats in, it will come into the bin. So in the litter we diverted in 2020, so just in 19 weeks with just three sea bins, we were able to get 13 kilograms of anthropogenic debris in total. So that's plastic litter, but also cans and other, you know, paper and those types of things. We get tens of thousands of pieces of small plastic debris in total. And a lot of these are pre-production pellets from industry. This year, with our 10 bins in the water for about 5 months, we estimate we'll collect about 50 kilograms of anthropogenic debris, which is equivalent to about 5,000 plastic water bottles. And it'll include hundreds of thousands of pieces of microplastic. So these things do make a difference, although we definitely need upstream solutions to stop them from going in the water in the first place. And so I'll talk later about what all the data that we collect is used for. We have students out there every day quantifying and characterizing not just how much we collect, but what we collect. And this data feeds into upstream solutions and projects that we use to better understand them. But what I really want to focus on tonight is our tagging trash project, where we took these plastic bottles. They're just plastic blender bottles meant to mimic your typical plastic debris. And we put a GPS tag inside. And our goal was to observe how floating plastic moves within and around the Toronto Harbor. And then to use that to determine where kind of these accumulation zones are, where we could put future trash capture devices. And of course, we also wanted to develop a hydrodynamic model to sort of predict the surface transport of macroplastics in the area. And so this is in collaboration with two students that I'll show on the next slide, but also Matthew Wells from U of T and Bogdan Plevka from the Ministry of the Environment. So Cassie Sherlock and Pat Sensison were the two students that kind of really led this project. So here I am basically to talk about their work. So I want to make sure that I give them credit. And Pat, actually, some of these slides are hers because the model is part of her PhD project. So Cassie was really involved in sort of putting this project together, working with TRCA to make plans to deploy and pick up the bottles and a lot of the outreach and communication and logistics. And Pat is taking all the data and creating models and thinking about what it all means. So this project at the moment is complete, but we will start again this summer up in the rivers, and I'll talk about that later. But basically the timeline for this project, just so that you can see, is we started last summer in May. And what we would do is we would throw the bottles out into the water. We'd throw about 30 at a time from different sites around the waterfront. We'd leave them out there for about a month, and then we'd collect them, and we'd throw again and we'd collect them. And our goal was to try to capture kind of the variability in different winds. And if we saw one trying about to escape or in a place where we thought we might lose it, we would go get it earlier. But I will tell you that I must be honest that we did not get all of them back, but we certainly were able to recover some, not more than some, but sometimes we had bottles escape, and I'll show you that on the maps. So this is sort of what they looked like. So this here is the actual tracker. I mean, it's inside that case, but here it is next to kind of a quarter, so you can see the size. And you can see here that we deployed them from multiple different sites in the harbor. So I'm gonna go over some of the data to show you where we threw them and where they went. So the first thing I'll talk about is just how far they traveled. So just literally thinking about net displacement. So where did we start them and where did they end? And if you look here at the trajectory of one bottle, you can see that they did a lot of crazy moving around, of course, day to day, but this is the initial place and the final place where we picked them up. And so we sort of saw three general trends with these, and some of them we called couch potatoes. These were the ones they didn't really go very far at all. In fact, they pretty much entered the water and stayed almost where we put them, which is not that different from the litter we see in the slips. The next thing we saw were kind of these, we call them trendy trackers, where they sort of had similar trajectories following wind patterns, and they traveled close to home. They weren't really leaving the harbor. In fact, most did not leave the harbor even within that month period, which is a good thing when we think about being able to capture the litter and getting it out of the harbor. But we did have some that we referred to as escape artists, where they did get out and we let a few go so we could kind of see where they went, or because we just weren't able to get them in time. And I'll show you those tracks in a second. So here it looks like kind of a big mess of spaghetti, where you have the yellow being the initial and the purple being the final. So I'll just sort of walk through the trends. So here you can see that the couch potatoes are the blue piece of the pie, and these really went less than 100 meters. And the reality is that the kind of the sensitivity of the trackers is such that we don't have full confidence over what happened in those first 100 meters. So they hardly moved at all, basically. Then I would say that actually most of them were these trendy trackers that went anywhere from 0.1 to 5 kilometers. Pretty typical distance. Some retained completely within the harbor, some pretty much stayed maybe going to the spit or going to nearby places along the shore, even some traveling outside, but like towards the Humber River. And then we had some, approximately 15%, we were able to capture quite a bit of these that were escaping the harbor and could escape the area, and they would kind of go in different directions depending on the winds, which I'll talk about in a second. The wind was really the most important thing. Of course, there are surface currents within the Toronto Harbor, but because of the nature of a plastic bottle, this type of floating debris that sort of sits up above the water, which is a lot of plastic pollution, the wind is really important. For the microplastic that might be a little bit more submerged, the surface currents also probably make a big difference, but of course, those are also affected by the wind. And so we could sort of look at what was the typical wind during this period when we were doing our project, and also what was happening with the wind when we actually deployed the bottles. So here you're looking at windrows, and this windrows is basically like a compass, and it sort of shows you where the wind is coming from and how strong the wind is. So for a northerly wind, the wind is coming from the north, it's heading south. And the longer this bar and the darker the color, the stronger the wind is. Do the same thing for easterly, southerly, and westerly. For the city of Toronto, the prevailing winds tend to come from the west or a little bit from the southwest. This was sort of the typical trajectory if we were throwing the bottles on a typical day throughout the summer. But of course, we did have storms, and sometimes we would throw these bottles either on purpose on different days to get to see some diversity, or because it was the nature of our scheduling, or they were already in the water and the winds changed and changed the trajectory of the bottles. So instead, we did actually get some diversity. So we certainly had quite a bit of bottles that followed the prevailing westerly winds. So you can see all the spaghetti behind you right now, but I'm going to take away some of those spaghettis and just show you the tracks where they were going with the prevailing westerly winds. So a lot of the bottles when thrown will head east towards the eastern part of the harbor, sometimes heading up into the shipping channel, which can be a hazard for ships, sometimes going up into the Keating Channel the opposite way, as you might expect, into the Don River. So this suggests that trash traps might be useful in these areas to keep the litter out. And in fact, when we originally wanted a trash wheel, we were going to put it in Keating Channel, and we discussed with the owners having the ramps be on both sides, recognizing that litter was going to come both from the harbor and also from the Don River. So you can create a mechanism to capture it as it's coming both ways, which is useful. For easterly winds, we certainly had these with storms. You can see here, it actually generally pushes them within the harbor some, heading over to Tommy Thompson Airport. The airport crew was quite kind about getting us our bottles back, but sometimes they did escape through the gap, and we would have them heading towards Humber River, for example. So in this case, we did talk about maybe putting some sort of a trap or some sort of mechanism here to keep them from escaping the harbor. The reality, as you know earlier, a lot of what we have right now is currently in slips, because the current technology we're using works best in slips. So new types of trash traps would be useful in these types of areas. We had some that pushed from the south into the north, but very little, and some, but again, very little, pushing from the north and heading into the south. The other thing you might notice, and I talked about these escape artists, is that some of these lines you can't quite see when I'm just showing you a picture of the harbor. And so zooming out, we can sort of show you where they went in Lake Ontario. So some went quite far. We actually did have escapees going all the way into New York, crossing the border, and some that went towards Hamilton. And we were actually able to retrieve one of these. A colleague in Burlington was able to pick it up off the beach. So we were able to find that tracker. We have a friend in Rochester. We asked him to go get this one, but it turned off before he could go get it. So there you have it. So overall, basically, you can see here some of the main trends. Most of them sort of stay nearby, which is useful when we're thinking about diverting litter from the lake before it gets out sort of into the broader lake. So diverting it from the harbor. So some of the outcomes of this project, when we actually first started planning this project, I would say that, of course, we were interested in the science. We were really thrilled to have Pat and Bogdan and Matthew come online interested in creating a hydrodynamic model. But when we started, we were really also interested in this as a big outreach and communication platform, as well as a means to inform both upstream policies, but also the downstream policies where we were figuring out where we can put future traps. So a hydrodynamic model is on its way, and Pat is working on that, and she's been presenting it at various conferences. We are using sort of what we learned to think about future traps, and I'll talk about that. And we also had a lot of outreach and communication. So we communicated in real time sort of where these trappers were at any one time. We gave them cute names. We named one John Tory so that we could follow it. I think that one escaped. So that was visible on our webpage, and we had an ongoing social media story throughout, as well as a blog at the end to show our results. So some of our next steps for this, first of all, we're using the data collected to inform where trash traps are. So most of the kind of the couch potatoes and the trendy trackers have informed where some more sea bins are. We will be doing this again in the Don River this summer. So probably in August, we'll be deploying from 4 sites up along the Don River to see. I think a lot of people have this idea that rivers are sort of these pipelines of your plastic litter to the ocean or to a lake. But the reality is they're more complex than that. And so we want to see what gets caught up in the riparian zone. How long does it take to come down the river? Does it come down the river? So we'll be doing that this summer. So if you see more orange bottles on the water, that's why. We currently are in the progress of doing design competition with U of T engineering students. So with Ports Toronto, we basically give them a problem, and the problem is to create a trash trapping device designed for some of these different locations that aren't slips. And the students design these, give you kind of a blueprint. They can give you a 3D printed model, and then we can decide who to contract to make it and where to actually put it. So we've done it with one group of students. This year, we're gonna do it with a second group of students. So we have a couple ideas. We will continue our trapping program. So you might see students this summer on the waterfront. They're up and down the waterfront and also at the Outer Harbor Marina. And we will continue working on our pollution prevention projects. And that's how I want to end my talk, is just talking a bit about some of the work we're doing that has been informed by what we find in the traps. A lot of people say, well, that's great, you're cleaning up, but cleaning up should be the last solution. The upstream solutions are critical, right, in order to prevent the plastic problem. So we take the data that we find both in the traps, but also in my research lab when we sample, for example, with the Ministry of the Environment or with Department of Fisheries and Oceans, to think about what are the types of solutions-based research we can do. So we have a project on pre-production pellets, styrofoam, microfibers, and single-use foodware. And I'll just talk briefly about each of those before I wrap up. So one of the most common small plastics we find in the traps are these pre-production pellets, which is the raw plastic material made from industry that is melted down and molded into the plastic products you're familiar with. We started working directly with the Ministry of the Environment and the Chemical Industry Association of Canada in order to both do outreach to these industries to say, hey, you have a problem, and B, think about solutions. So we're currently talking to industry as well as the government about a regulation provincially. But we also this year are working with six companies that are upstream of the Humber River that have agreed to put these traps on their site to see if we can see a difference downstream. On microfibers, these are more related to our laboratories research. They're too small to see in our traps, but a lot of what we see when we look in sport fish, for example, in Lake Ontario, are tiny little microfibers in the gut content of fish, for example. A lot of this does come from washing machines. We wash our clothes. Those bits of fibers go out the washing machine and into the wastewater. We find that if you put a filter on a washing machine, you can divert about 80% of those microfibers. So we're trapping trash in people's houses. With Georgian Bay Forever, we had them in about 100 homes, and we were able to see a difference at the wastewater treatment plant scale. So that work is right now informing some policies, including one in Ontario about basically mandating filters on washing machines. For our polystyrene, we were noticing that in our traps, we were seeing styrofoam, but it wasn't coming from, or didn't look like most of it was coming from, that food packaging. And so we started working with the Ministry of the Environment and using an instrument to see if there were bromines inside, and there were. And so we think about 50% of the foam we see in our traps and on beaches is from construction. And so we're just finishing this science piece up and then starting to think about what do you do about construction as a source of styrofoam. And then finally, the city is moving forward with programs to try to reduce single-use foodware. Of course, the federal government just released bans yesterday for some of these single-use food items. So we're working with the Toronto Environmental Alliance, trying to go and survey and work with businesses to see what are the benefits of going to reusables, how does it affect their pocketbook, so how does it help them in terms of how much they spend and the profits they make, and of course, how does it help the environment, trying to both reduce the barriers to using reusables and seeing what these companies need from the city as they make this transition. And so with that, I want to thank all of our collaborators. We do nothing alone. We work with a ton of stakeholders in the city, and it's a lot of fun. And then thank you all for listening, and I look forward to questions at the end. Thank you.
Okay, that's great. Thanks. Thanks, Chelsea. So we've got a few minutes now, and I see that some questions are starting to come in. So maybe are you good to just answer some of these now, and then maybe we'll get to as many as we can, and maybe if we have time at the end, we can answer more, if that's okay.
Sure, absolutely. Okay. Do you want me to read them from the chat, or
That's okay. I can read them for you here. So our first question was from Steve Tower. So Steve's asking, can you explain some of the plastic categories and potential sources? So for example, pre-production pellets, things like that. And I think you kind of answered some of that in your presentation, but if there's any places you want to elaborate or anything.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it's really important. It is the reason why we take the data. We believe that you should be trapping trash and diverting it, but we also think the data is super critical. So I'm just going to bring myself back to that slide so I can look at the sources. I would say most of what we find in our sea bins and in our cleanups are, a lot of them are single-use plastic items. So plastic cutlery and other single-use foodware, say coffee cups and lids and the takeout containers that we use. A lot of them are food wrappers, but we also find, you know, all of that is related to the single-use plastic that some of this legislation is taking care of. What is a little bit different are these pre-production pellets from industry, which I talked about. So that's really important for us to understand, because that is a different mitigation strategy than the federal government's currently working on. Cigarette butts. We see so many cigarette butts. A lot of people aren't aware that they are plastic. So this summer, we're starting a big educational campaign on cigarette butts. We'll have big posters on the subway or the streetcar stalls right on Queens Quay and Spadina in just a few weeks, actually. And we'll start a big educational campaign with the Water Brothers and trying to get to see if it matters, if people understand, like the same person who wouldn't throw a plastic bottle on the ground might throw a cigarette butt. And we want to kind of try to change that thinking and think about policies around that. For example, taking the plastic filter out of the cigarette butts, although I'm not sure that's popular for cigarette companies. Other things, the styrofoam from construction, that was another interesting find. Again, that's not going to be taken care of under the policies currently introduced. So we're trying to think about some of these different sources that are kind of outside the current federal government's plans and think about how we can inform solutions to those, if that helps answer that question.
Okay, that's great. Thanks, Chelsea. And our next question here is from Janet Harrison. So she's asking, can the trash collectors handle the storm surge going through the storm sewers into the lake?
It's a great question. Actually, was a big reason why we didn't. So when we couldn't get a trash bill in the Don River, we asked about putting it in a slip, for example, Bathurst Key. And Toronto Water really didn't like that idea because of the stormwater sewage overflow system. They didn't want us to be collecting some of that type of debris in the trap. So we don't have any issues with the sea bins. They do pretty well. We empty them daily, which is critical, because if you do wait, they can get too heavy and break. But it is one of the reasons why we want something big like a trash wheel that can handle a lot of the larger debris. And we do have to be careful about putting them in places where we're not subjecting our students to, say, bacteria or something that's not necessarily safe for them. So in Bathurst Key, we actually do no work for that reason.
Okay, great. Okay, thanks, Chelsea. And then maybe one more question here. So a question from Dylan. So do you expect single-use plastic bans to significantly reduce water trash levels in the near future?
I am very intrigued to see what we start to see in our local cleanups and in our bins. We do see a lot of these items that were banned. And so it might make a difference when the federal government banned microbeads in face wash. We don't see them very often in our nets anymore for microplastics when we're sampling. So I do think it will turn off the tap for those products. Do I think it'll make a really big difference in the overall amount that we see? I don't know. Like I said, a lot of these sources are different. And so what I think is great about the federal policy is that there's some holistic pieces to it that are more than just kind of the banning of the six items, that allow for banning more items if needed in the future, and also for trying to reduce the amount of plastic waste and sort of produce a more circular economy. But we'll see. I think we definitely need some policies targeting microplastics in order for me, as most of what I do besides this is microplastic, for me to really see a difference. But again, we'll see. And that's why we take the data. But that's not me being pessimistic. I'm very happy about what the government has done.
Okay. Great. Thanks. Thanks, Chelsea. And yeah, so you do have a lot of interest in your presentation, your project here, as I can see in the chat and in the Q&A. So unfortunately, we do have to move on. We've got a fairly packed agenda for tonight. I'll just flag, you've got a few comments from Neil, who seems like he's hoping to maybe share some data, things like that. But maybe, Chelsea, maybe if you don't mind, if you can, maybe just address some of those comments through the chat and the Q&A, that would be great. And then maybe also if we have time at the end, maybe there's we may have some time to get to some of them, but I would like to move on to our next presentation. But thanks again, Chelsea, that was excellent. Very awesome, interesting project work that you all are doing. So thank you very much for being here.
Thank you, no, thanks.
So our next presenter tonight is Calvin Hitch. So Calvin is a project manager of hydrometrics for Toronto and Region Conservation Authority. He graduated from the Environmental Technology Program at Georgian College of Applied Arts and Technology in 2011, while spending 4 years in consulting before starting his career at TRCA. Since 2017, Calvin has been primarily working on tributary sampling and monitoring projects for the North Shore of Lake Ontario. He continues to steer a curriculum at Georgian College as a guest speaker and a member of the Academic Advisory Board and is currently Secretariat of the Lake Ontario Interagency Science Working Group. Current focuses include land to lake connections, nutrient monitoring, tributary loading studies, driving collaborative projects with partners for Lake Ontario water quality programs and state-of-the-art design and monitoring stations utilizing real-time telemetry technologies. So welcome, Calvin, and whenever you're ready, if you can take control, share your screen, and whenever you're ready, you can start.
All right, thank you so much. Great presentation, Chelsea. That was awesome. So thanks for joining me. This is just a presentation for the Greater Toronto and Area Water Quality Network. There we go. So it's not really a picture of ingredients for soup. It really is a metaphor. I love soup and I love cooking, but you know, everything that we're doing is all working in collaboration. So this GTA Water Quality Network, it's been built upon for over the last decade, but it's really accelerated in the last few years. Numerous partners, projects, and initiatives have allowed us to add layers of complexity and sensors and different initiatives to kind of build this up to what it is today, just adding an ingredient at a time. Today, we have the 30 auto samplers, over 25 sondes and sensors, each all telemetered, and ranging from on all our watersheds, all the way up from the tributaries down to the mouths of Lake Ontario. So the whole network is a massive, it's a labor of love from everyone that's involved. It's been a really big privilege working with all our partners and all the colleagues that work on this. It's blood, sweat, and tears, and it's crazy at times. You know, we seem to kind of work around the clock, and there is, you know, it never seems to rain on weekends or in evenings, or sorry, weekdays and evenings. And everyone has a really different style. Like everyone brings, you know, different perspectives to installs and to, you know, being efficient and you know, making this work in the long run. We're ultimately always up against Mother Nature, so you're always trying to play catch up and make sure that things kind of work smoothly. So what's in the stock? Like, what's the basis of what we're doing? We typically have stations outfitted with rather solar or hydro connections. They include ISCO auto samplers, 6712s or avalanches, depending on the project, Campbell data loggers, which are super, super flexible. And then, you know, we have our instruments in the creeks. We can trigger samplers, whether that's a bubbler, an in-situ level sensor, connectivity sensor. And then we have all our sondes and sensors, which really add that supplementary data to what we're collecting. It goes around 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and we're always kind of looking at that data. So stock, the power of this whole network is the collaboration, is the fact that the infrastructure is there. you know, whenever someone's doing a project, you know, especially in monitoring, the capital cost to start up is crazy. Like it's a big undertaking. So if we have the things in place, you know, we can bring partners on, or we can bring academics or researchers to help, you know, augment things or answer specific questions. It's a big sandbox, and everyone is, you know, so cooperative, and they see the science and the great and the bigger picture, which is really, really beneficial to, you know, our watersheds in Lake Ontario. So what are we doing? The methods, the reasoning, the science, and the madness. I don't know if you guys love Anthony Bourdain. He's an amazing author, and it definitely ties into the theme of being in the kitchen. Living the weather and triggering. You know, in these roles, everyone seems to be a little, you know, part weather person, you know, part forecaster. We're watching models, we're, you know, we're glued to the weather network, we're scrambling when there's a pop-up thunderstorm. And the second slide is most of us late at night when we're trying to capture a storm and trying to trigger all the auto samplers. It's chaos. It's you know, it makes you pull your hair up, but we're able to get it done. We're able to collect a lot of amazing science, which is great. So we're flow weighting. We trigger our auto samplers, they run for at least a 42 or 48 hour program. And then each bottle is tied to a different flow rate. We proportion those bottles into a larger composite, and then we bottle that and send it off to our laboratories. It's, you know, just to be noted, you can kind of see in this photo here, you know, at the beginning bottles on the far side, you can see how dark and, you know, full of dirt and sediment they are, for, you know, indicative of first flush. And then, you know, as it goes to the peak of the hydrograph and down, it usually subsides. You know, our event mean composites really show great science for trying to figure out loads. So we bottle our samples, like what usually happens next? So we always submit them to a lab, you know, rather Toronto Water's lab, the MECP lab, or even one of our partners, Widrell at York Durham. You know, we submit them for analysis, whatever the analysis suite, it comes back, and then it goes into our data storage, QA and QC. TRCA is really fortunate to be using aquatic informatics and Aquarius samples. You know, our input of data is dragging and dropping into our program. It categorizes it, it sorts it, it flags outliers. You know, initial QA QC is done instantaneously. All the stats are done, so it's, you know, it's very easy to see, you know, how the storm stacked up in terms of, you know, even the yearly results or the results over the station, you know, for the entire data set. So from there, we use aquatic time series. Aquatic time series is how we import all our time series data, so all our stage data, conductivity, all our, you know, sons. We're able to do our drift checks or calibrations. And you know, it's been really great through Toronto Water. We've developed a connector between the two pieces of software. So what we're able to do is we're able to generate loads instantaneously, like not proper loadings, but like the load, you know, the mass event loads for a storm. So it's not like the end all and be all of tools, but it is, you know, it gives insight to what's going on, you know, and what's being pushed to Lake Ontario. What the tool does is it basically references, you know, if there's chloride, you know, sampled on the 23rd of June, it's going to look to the same storm and see when the bottle count of sampler was being triggered, and then it totalizes that flow, and then it multiplies it by the concentration. It took about a year to develop, but it's given us some real leverage in terms of what we can do and what our deliverables can be for our partners. So why are we doing it? You know, a lot of the, you know, TRCA's work, so much of it, at least from my perspective, is more tributary based. And although we do have Lake Ontario folk, you know, all over, it's the land to lake connections though, you know, regardless of what happens in the upper Humber, you know, it is all flowing downstream. It's going to Lake Ontario, it's impacting fisheries, it's impacting, you know, aquatic habitat. You know, it's, it would be naive to think that, you know, there isn't, it's not all interconnected, which is really cool. So why are we all doing this? By the way, I love the Swedish Chef and the Muppets. He's a great character. where are we doing this? We have 30 sites plus over the GTA. We have several large projects and initiatives. Most of them are involved with some form of loading calculations, Lake Ontario. It does depend on the project or who's doing what. I'm going to talk about the projects. It's so hard to parse these down to like a single slide. Each of these can be broken out into like their own presentation, so bear with me. The first one being the Toronto Wet Weather Flow Tributary Monitoring Program. It's a four-year program consisting of 28 locations within Toronto Water's jurisdiction. It is funded by Toronto Water, which are, you know, such huge partners for TRCA. We're targeting 15 storm events a year, 10 base flow samples per site, you know, with blanks and duplicates and the whole gamut. Four dry weather composites as well being submitted, all to the Toronto Water Lab. Includes several multi-parameter sons throughout the jurisdiction. This year, the target watershed is the Humber. So we're gonna have at least conductivity, but conductivity, if not multi-parameter sons, on all the tributaries that are being monitored in the Humber River, which is great for that, you know, sub-watershed scale type of data that comes in. It's great to see what's happening at the lake, but it's really interesting to seeing what's happened in the different catchments. There are a lot of cutting edge technologies for this. We have temporary stations, which we're moving on like a six month basis. And they're actually utilizing Sontech IQs, which is a acoustic Doppler, where we will take the profile of a stream through a survey, input it into the software. And then that's gonna allow us to generate the rating curves at a, you know, a relatively quick pace, as opposed to the arduous nature of, you know, developing a rating curve by manual flow measurements. And like it could take ages. Discharge being calculated at all our sites across the project. So we really can see the water quality changes throughout how it moves in from Toronto proper down to the lake. It's part of the Wet Weather Flow Master Plan. So it's a 10-year cycle. The last iteration of the project was 2008 to 2012. This iteration should be starting up in the next month or so and carrying on to 2026. So North Shore Lake Ontario water quality monitoring. I mean, this definitely ties in better to the overarching theme of the night. So this is five water quality sondes. We installed them at Rouge, Humber, Highland, Etobicoke Creek, and Don River. Massive. It was a big undertaking to do. Like, we did it right before the winter ice up helped with help from MECP. So, you know, again, they're a huge help and big partners, which give us a hand. This data is being pulled and fed into a water quality model from the North Shore Lake Ontario. It's not just taking the SON data, it's taking data from, you know, from weather stations, I believe from buoys, from outflows, from wastewater treatment plants, to create that that nearshore model. It's part of the CTC Source Protection Group and some other initiatives. Further rollout of the project includes Mimico Creek. So once that's in place, we'll have every single one of the tributaries of the GTA and Toronto and TRCA's jurisdiction, you know, not only telemeter, but we'll have a sond, and we can have real-time outputs of what's going into Lake Ontario. Other locations include outside, like the actual GTA proper is Duffins and Carruthers Creek, but, you know, Durham is so close. MECP tributary monitoring. Again, this project could take, you know, it could be a whole new presentation of itself. It's comprised of a multi-year and multi-agency initiative funded by MECP. They're amazing partners, and they, you know, they have the big picture of what, you know, what they want to do and what we want to monitor for the science. And it's included several years of tributary samples, you know, huge freshets. I think we're up to over 70 sample or storm events per station across the network. It's not just GTA, so we have the main stations that we're talking about: Dawn, Humber, Etobicoke, Credit, you know, and even GRCA jurisdiction out in the Ganaraska. It really does give a good picture of what's going on at the North Shore, you know, over the last few years. It it highlights the collaborative nature of, you know, federal, provincial, CAs, all working together, all pitching in, you know, we can't, nothing's done in isolation. Like everyone needs each other's help, and these roles, you know, they blend so well with everyone being so, you know, so willing to lend a hand. Etobicoke and Mimico chloride monitoring. These are six sites through Etobicoke and Mimico Creeks. The TRCA releases an annual water quality report, and chloride was flagged as one of the runaway pollutants in both water courses. So through a COA grant, we're now looking at a multi-year project to look at the, you know, the impacts and the amount of chloride through the six stations as it moves through the two tributaries. Everything's real time, and you know, it will show at least what's going to Lake Ontario. And last but not least, again, it's outside GTA's proper jurisdiction, but it does highlight, you know, really important work going on. Ajax phosphorus monitoring. We're looking at two sewer sheds in Ajax, which spill directly into Lake Ontario. We did the installs for these, and you can see the outfall, and you can see the lake from underground. The project is an effort with University of Waterloo, Environment Canada, MECP, and TRCA. And University of Waterloo is looking at the phosphorus speciation through these storms. It's been 2 years now of sampling, and they've developed a preliminary model for nutrient loading to nearshore Lake Ontario. So big impact for residents and anyone who uses that, that interface between water and, you know, beaches. So why are we doing this? I was looking for a Michelin star, but I'm going with fine food. So like, what is the overarching goal, and what are we working towards? In my mind, it's this. So these stations by the end of the year will have high density of every single one. Is going to have a sampler. It's probably going to have a sonde or a conductivity sensor, and they're all going to be real time. You know, the entire western portion of GTA will be completely outfitted. You know, this high density network of sensors and samplers, it really does push some amazing science, and it's what I'd like to work towards, at least for the rest of the jurisdiction, to have, you know, to have that data and to be able to, you know, answer individual and unique questions, which may be, you know, specific to like the subwatersheds and catchments. So real-time data, you know, the other thing we do is we're also able to, you know, to generate these real-time water quality websites for our partners or internal stakeholders to be able to view. You know, it's not from a like a flood forecasting and warning perspective, but it really does help us, you know, triage what needs to be cleaned, what needs to be repaired, you know, keep things up and running. Like I said before, it's a labor of love, and these things take a lot of babysitting. So it allows us to be able to keep things running relatively smoothly, which is very appreciated. So what's all this supporting, like the great St. Lawrence market? More science, you know. One of our former TRCA colleagues, he had this great vision for, you know, if you build it, they will come. And it allows researchers to come to us and, you know, to leverage the network that we have, and to, you know, it's, you know, one ingredient to the pot of soup is not that difficult, as opposed to trying to make the whole thing by yourself. You know, this sandbox environment where everyone's working together, it works so well. I feel so privileged to be able to be a part of it. And it's really exciting because like the things we're doing are, you know, are cutting edge and really fascinating. So what are we using? And if anyone's done any type of in-water, in-creek work, it's what are we cleaning? Because everything gets so dirty so fast. So some of the pots and pans. We have multi-parameter sondes. You know, they're great units. We're able to use handheld or deployed. They're wiped. You know, we're able to get a suite of different parameters. I know that sonde that you're seeing, the flowy end is actually, it's upside down, but that was before we deployed it, before anyone cracks a joke. We have lots of Campbell data loggers. They're super flexible. We're able to dial into them, you know, controller samplers. We're able to, you know, add a, you know, a suite of instruments, whether it's 4-20, you know, SDI-12, whatever it is, we can monitor it. So it's, you know, it adds to that layered approach to what we're doing at each of our sites. I talked about it before, the workhorse of our network are samplers. These escalator samplers, they're rather a 24 or 14 bottle configuration, refrigerated or non-refrigerated. It allows us to sample multi-day events. And, especially in the freshet season in the spring, we're running these back-to-back for two or three cycles. We're really trying to get those long duration, freshet events that can provide that critical science, at least for, wintertime activity. And we're also really fortunate to have loads of custom made stainless steel enclosures. We're battling nature 24/7. You're always trying to fight something from getting hit from a tree or taken out by ice, fouled or taken away completely. It's a nature of the beast. It's part of the business. Nothing's a one size fits all approach. You're always tweaking, you're always changing, you're always trying to make something better. It's a living thing. You can't just place it and leave it and expect it to be okay. So I won't go through the list. Thanks to all the collaborators and colleagues, our big partners, Toronto Water, Ministry of the Environment, Conservation and Parks, you guys are amazing. Without you, we couldn't do it all. There's a lot of people behind the scenes and they're all so uniquely valuable. I appreciate everything everyone does. So I started the presentation with a metaphor. I kind of want to end it on a metaphor as well. Anthony Bourdain said, personally, I think there's real danger for taking food too seriously, and food should be part of the bigger picture. And so is all this work. I find water quality really important and I love monitoring, but it's part of, what's going on in Lake Ontario and what's happening with climate change. And that's something we shouldn't forget. I find it really important and also really exciting. Thank you. If you have any questions, feel free to email me and reach out.
Great. Thanks. Thanks, Calvin. Thanks for being here. Thanks for that. That's a lot of work. Sir, I wish I had have eaten prior to this because, it made me very hungry, all of your food analogies throughout the your presentation. We have a few minutes here, so you've got a few questions. First, I guess more of just a comment from Ania, asking to if she can contact you and has given an email there. So maybe if you afterwards could just maybe respond to that in the chat, that'd be great.
Sure, absolutely.
And then a question from Paul. So I imagine there'll be many challenges for this, but could you imagine being able to obtain real-time data from viral loads for monitoring outbreaks like COVID-19?
I am not an expert on the analysis which happens for COVID-19. I'm sure there's someone in this room that knows better than me. I'm assuming that it's laboratory analysis, so I don't think you could. But if someone wants to speak up, go for it. It's just not me.
I'm just going to say that there is some work going on with wastewater treatment plants and COVID monitoring. I would say probably somebody from McMaster University might be able to answer that. I don't have the name right now. So once I come up with it, I'll let you know.
Okay. All right. Thanks. Thanks, Nadine. we have another question from Sarah. So do you monitor for toxic substances and prioritize carcinogens emitted? I have worked on Toronto Rights to Know bylaws and a Chemtrack program requiring companies to report harmful emissions. Toronto Public Health need to be involved.
So there are some pollutants of concern and things on the horizon that we're starting to analyze for now. We're talking to researchers to look at like 6-PPD quinone, PFAS monitoring, things of that nature. We can't get it all, but we also find that there's always a bottleneck in terms of labs that can analyze for some things and costs and all those kind of nuanced issues. But there's definitely toxic substances that we're looking at.
Perfect. Okay, thanks. Thanks, Calvin. And then one here from Samuel. Is there a water quality parameter that we aren't currently capturing that you believe that we should?
I think chloride everywhere, like conductivity at all the tributary sites. That I'd like that. It's so pervasive and the impacts are massive. We could definitely use less road salt in this world. So thank you.
Awesome. Okay. All right. Thanks. Thanks again, Calvin. Thanks for that and for being here tonight. I really appreciate it. So with that, I think we'll go on to our last presentations of the night. So it's a joint presentation by Nadine Benoit and Lauren Barth. So Nadine is a surface water scientist working in the Great Lakes unit of the Ministry of Environment, the Ministry of Environmental Monitoring and Reporting Branch. She works on a variety of water quality issues in the near shore of Great Lakes. Nadine is a member of the Toronto Region Remedial Action Plan Steering Committee and is involved with multiple studies to assess improvements to the Toronto area of concern. And our other speaker, Dr. Lauren Barth, is a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Toronto, researching how urbanization and climate change affect timing, amount, and types of nutrients entering Lake Ontario, and what impacts this will have on the nearshore community of the lake. Lauren completed her PhD in ecology and evolutionary biology at University of Toronto in 2020, with her background in planktonic food webs, wind-induced spatial patterns, and size-based indicators of lake health. Lauren's research interests are geared towards application-based science that tackle issues related to how multiple stressors alter food webs and energy transfer in freshwater ecosystems. With that, I will pass it off to Nadine. And it looks like you're already sharing your screen. Yep. We can see you're in the presentation mode.
I'm in presenter mode.
Yeah.
So can you see my notes?
I can see, yes.
Yeah. Okay, so let me change that. I'll just stop presenting for a second.
Sure.
Okay. Okay, what can you see now?
You're good now. You can see your title slide. And no notes. Yep.
Okay, perfect. So thank you very much. So before I start, I just wanted to acknowledge that the name I was looking for was Tom Edge. He used to work with Environment Canada, and he does a lot of microbial work along the Toronto region. But he's also been involved in some COVID-19 work looking at wastewater treatment plants and tracking and whatnot. So that would be a person you could reach out to for that information. So. Okay, so we're going to talk about land-to-lake water quality across an urban gradient on the north shore of Lake Ontario. You heard previously from Calvin, and it was a great little analogy about how to make a soup, and this is kind of what happens at the end of the soup, which is Lake Ontario. And Lauren will be talking a little bit about the ingredients that make up the soup on the top end on the watershed side of things. Before we start, I'd like to acknowledge Todd Howell, who's our silent partner in this, but who is very much person who started this work and initiated this incredible amount of work that's been done in the past few years along the Lake Ontario shoreline. So before we delve into this urbanized area of Lake Ontario, let's look at a few key concepts that frame the work we'll be presenting. Lake Ontario's ecosystem first began throwing troubles from the 1940s to the 1970s, with excessive nutrients, primarily phosphorus, resulting in massive mats of algae along the shoreline and poor water quality all around. This led to lake-wide phosphorus management for Lake Ontario and the other Great Lakes through the Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement. From the late 1970s to the late 80s, we saw vast improvements as a result of reductions in phosphorus use, for example, in laundry detergents, and improvements to wastewater treatments. Then came the invasion of dreissena mussels, first the zebra mussels, then the quagga mussels, and these invaders completely re-engineered much of the Great Lakes ecosystems, including Lake Ontario, by feeding on floating algae and clearing waters of the lake. Today, mussels comprise 90% of the total animal biomass in the Great Lakes. And once again, we see large algal mats along the shores of Lake Ontario. This is in part because mussels keep nutrients close to the near shore and provide ideal substrate for the algae cladophora to grow on. So as you can probably see, Lake Ontario's ecosystem health continues to change, and the conditions leading to poor water quality in the lake is pretty much a moving target. There's also been some profound landscape changes over the years, as we've probably seen many of you along the shoreline here, in particular with urban sprawl. This is a great graphic presented by CBC Radio Canada. And on the left-hand side in yellow, you see how much development existed in 2001 with growth in the middle. There was a 30% population growth in the region over the past two decades, which resulted in over 34% area growth. With that come the multiple pressures to infrastructure, including roads, waste and stormwater treatment, and of course, abundant hard surfaces and habitat loss. Let's focus for a minute on the zone we're presenting on today. The concrete jungle you see on the satellite image in the large form here is where over 56% of Ontarians live. It's also an important zone of interaction for our water resources. Over 3.5 million people live in this area of Lake Ontario's coastline. We have four large wastewater treatment plants that flow out into the nearshore zone, seven urban rivers that feed into the lake, each of them having various levels of imperviousness and urbanization. And we have over 100 stormwater outfalls that spill directly into the lake along Toronto's western waterfront. And yet this lake is a valuable resource. We depend on it for high drinking water quality at our five intakes. We use 11 official beaches to keep us cool in the summer. And we have the Toronto and Region Area of Concern, which is one of the Great Lakes' 43 areas of concern for degraded water quality. So we interact with this incredible resource on a continuous basis. So we do need water quality information for Western Lake Ontario. The stress on the nearshore is quite high, with the largest and most concentrated population on the Canadian side of the Great Lakes, with growing urbanization in the watersheds and increased sensitivity of water resources to extreme weather events. There are large infrastructure projects currently underway to improve water quality along the Toronto and Mississauga waterfronts, and we need baseline data to basically evaluate whether we will see improvements as a result of these projects. Finally, we need this information for the development of our phosphorus targets for Lake Ontario. We know that nutrient loads are high, but we don't know its relevance and linkage in lake eutrophication under current conditions. So what's our current baseline in Western Lake Ontario? What's our regional footprint? Will we see a difference in improvements? Will the infrastructure work underway help us delist our beneficial use impairments for eutrophication and undesirable algae? This is a story in parts. In 2018, we did a study, MECP did a study on the water quality along the waterfront of Toronto and Mississauga. And part of the questions we were trying to answer is, well, what happens when loadings from our various tributaries hit the shoreline? How long does poor water quality linger along the shoreline? And how bad can it actually get? And following alongside this work and touched upon by Calvin, who talked about how the system was set up, we started to look at urban rivers as part of a study from 2018 to 2020 and beyond even now. And Lauren's gonna cover that, including how does watershed size, land use and season affect river water quality? Do river loading patterns line up with observations along the waterfront? And when is water quality most impacted? So why did we do all this work in 2018? Well, it's been 10 years since we had last assessed water quality along the Toronto shoreline. And there have been many changes along the waterfront, both on the land side and in the lake itself. However, conditions have been difficult to quantify in an integrated and holistic manner that addresses water quality at a regional scale. So in 2018, the Ministry of Environment, Conservation and Parks conducted a series of surveys spanning 60 kilometers of the shoreline from Mississauga and Toronto from the Credit River in the southwest to the Rouge River in the northeast. It's the first time we've tried to be inclusive of the whole urban waterfront in the area so that we could assess where the problems in water quality lie. The objectives of the study were pretty diverse. Some were process-driven, such as looking at how weather patterns and seasonality affect water quality. Others were focused on topical water resources questions, the amounts of algae or eutrophication in general. We know there's substantial nutrient loading along the coastline. Do we have excessive amounts at all of algae growing out in the lake in the water column? Are there blooms occurring? A more recent issue relates to what actually grows on the bottom of Lake Ontario. In this area, we're mostly dealing with the filamentous green algae cladophora, which ends up washing onto the shore and causing no end of nuisance to people who live and live by and use the shoreline. And finally, how does this area compare to the rest of the lake, and what is the regional footprint? This type of work is difficult to do in such a heterogeneous environment. Water quality varies from extremely poor to really good, and there's a dynamic mix of conditions at play. But thanks to some of the tools, such as geographic information systems and developments in our monitoring technology and methods over the years, we've come up with a way of trying to do this. So first, in this study, we took 60 kilometers of shoreline and created 10 study blocks seen in the different color groupings. With these 10 units, we looked at a gradient of distance from the shoreline, moving offshore with distances of 750 meters from the shore, so the very near shore, intermediate mid-shore zones from 750 meters to 3 kilometers, and then the interface with the open lake greater than 3 kilometers offshore. Overall, this amounts to over 300 kilometers square of area monitored. We use multiple spatial scales to describe conditions with the overarching goal to characterize and interpret water quality over the coastline. And we wanted to examine how human interactions on the shoreline and in watersheds affect resources and the ecology of the samples and the ecology of the coastline. We took samples at discrete locations along portions of the shoreline. We measured mixing gradients at various discharge points and measured currents, temperature, and conductivity using deployed instrumentation that was left in the lake. This work is all part of an interactive set of elements, as Calvin alluded to. But also some of the work that we've been doing with Environment Canada to look at monitoring the ecology of the bottom of the lake and cladophora at sentinel sites in conjunction with our partners. As I was saying earlier, we've developed fairly sophisticated monitoring techniques for spatially characterizing the area based on the use of real-time field sensors, which is what you see in this manifold on the right-hand side pictures. We use GIS technologies in a desktop exercise to anticipate where we can expect variability. So that's where you see the map where we have a little area that we're following, a track line. And using the information we get from our boat surveys, we can then integrate models to compare and contrast locations along the shoreline over time. So essentially, we follow these prescribed tracks and we take continuous sensor measurements at 5-meter intervals, with occasional water samples for lab analysis. And we collect large amounts of spatially detailed information that we can then use models to model conditions as shown in the bottom right-hand map of the image, right-hand map that you see in the image there. I don't know if anybody's seeing my, are you seeing my mouse this way, Don? No?
Yeah, I can see your, I can see your mouse, yeah.
Perfect. Okay, I'll do that then. Okay, so what do we find? The overarching result is that water quality on the Toronto Mississauga waterfront is very different depending on where you are. There's a strong east to west gradient with water quality east of Toronto Harbour and the island being much better than the west side. This is reflected in the colored heat map that you see on the bottom of the slide. This heat map uses conductivity as a general surrogate for water quality. It can tell you where water is coming in to the lake from the rivers and outfalls, and it's effective at depicting the variability in water quality at a fine scale. In the context of survey blocks we mentioned earlier, on the top right hand of the slide, you see the histogram And these blocks are showing near shore to offshore zone. And you can see here that the bars to the east of Toronto, of Toronto Island, so this zone here, are generally much lower than those to the west. Also, in most cases, the bars closest to shore within 750 meters is higher than further out into the lake. Why is this happening? If you look at the GTA watersheds mapped in the top left corner, you can see that there are more rivers in blue here, these blue watersheds that are flowing into the west side of Toronto compared to the east in the orange watersheds here. So basically there's a whole lot more water coming from these areas in the west side. And that's a big driver of water quality across the waterfront. The poorest water quality found in the study is in the Toronto Harbour. That's not really an unusual finding. The major driver of water quality is the input from the Don River, which, as we know, is a completely urbanized river with relatively poor water quality. So when it enters through the harbor through the Keating Channel, waters mix and then push out through the west and east gaps into Lake Ontario. The harbor is shallow, so it's only about 10 meters deep. So water flushes through the system within about a week. But while the water flushes through the harbor, it brings with it really high concentrations of phosphorus that you can see in these left-hand most bars right there. So the inner harbor numbers are a lot higher than what's going on in the outer harbor. Now you would expect that these high concentrations would be reflect in the amount of algal growth that happens looking at chlorophyll concentrations. However, we only see moderate amounts of algae in the harbor. It's certainly elevated relative to the open lake, but it's not as high as one would expect with the nutrient levels that come into the harbor. So with a fast flushing time, the water and its nutrients does not hang around in the harbor long enough for large populations of algae to develop. Outside of Toronto Harbour, we see water quality impacts to the southwest along the coastline between the Humber Bay and the Credit River. Water quality in this area is periodically poor, and this is demonstrated in the colored map here on the right-hand side. We use nitrate here to reflect loading into the lake from the land. And one of the most important messages here is that water quality along the waterfront in the area is impacted by a confluence of loading. In this case, loadings from the Humber River, one of the city's largest watersheds, are coming out into a zone which also receives water from the Humber Bay wastewater treatment plant. And there's also a lot of stormwaters flowing into the area. These discharges converge, and much of the time flow across the shoreline towards the west, as you can see in the satellite imagery here on the left. The numbers on the color graph are concentrations of phosphate, which is a form of phosphorus that is most easily available to algae. And these numbers are quite elevated in the lake. You would expect to see no more than 2 micrograms per liter, yet some of these concentrations are in the 20 micrograms per liter range, which you would expect would result in algal growth. So as mentioned, one of our objectives was to look at algae levels out into the lake. We really found no evidence in the nearshore open waters of excessive amounts of algae or blooms of algae in the water column. So that's the good news. This is somewhat paradoxical because we found evidence of strongly elevated levels of biologically available phosphorus. So what's going on? In this picture, you see basically the offshore region of the Ashbridges Bay sewage treatment plant. And you can tell here that the birds are hanging out pretty much where the outfall is. The Ashbridges Bay sewage treatment plant is one of the largest on the Great Lakes and probably one of the largest in Canada. The colored map on the bottom left is a nitrate heat map with printed numbers showing phosphorus concentrations. And you can see where the outfall plume mixes and moves along the shoreline towards the west. So I can show that there. The outfall location is near the spot where all the galls and waterfall are, like I said. We also have histograms on the right that show chlorophyll levels within the same Ashbridges Bay zone block of the study. And the concentrations here are all well below 2 micrograms per liter chlorophyll A, which is low and indicates very little algae. This whole block of shoreline from the near shore to the offshore has low overall algal growth, even with high concentrations of nutrients coming out from the outfall. So why is that? Well, the answer lies in understanding water movements in the area. I really love how Chelsea's talk kind of talked about the whole water movements, and so this is the other aspect of it. So water adjacent to the Toronto-Mississauga shoreline moves fairly briskly with typically modest, strong currents. Near surface currents appear to move along shore east and west the majority of time, and these currents are flowing at a rate of 15 to 16 centimeters per second, quite fast. We think that what's happening is that because of these movements, algae are not staying in place, so they are not taking in the high nutrients long enough to actually grow. It's just being washed and flushed away, and this is a general theme for the waterfront and why you see less of a biological growth response than you would expect based on the nutrients. Now, having said that, there's another aspect of the algae problem, and that's with respect to what's growing on the bottom of the lake. These filamentous green algae called cladophora attach to hard substrate at the bottom of the lake, and they appear to have lots of surface areas and habitats to which they could attach. The areas in dark gray in the maps here, in the inset, show where the cladophora have substrate to grow on. And the picture you see in the backdrop is from a few years ago at a monitoring site in Scarborough that we study along with Environment Canada. You see large lawns of cladophora. We now need to ask, how do the nutrient loadings along the waterfront factor into this problem of excessive algae on the lake bed? It's a complicated story that goes beyond today's talk, but it's an issue we can see throughout Lake Ontario wherever there is suitable substrate for them to grow. And this has to do with the dricenid mussels, so zebra and quagga mussels, cleaning the water column and keeping valuable nutrients on the lake bottom. With more light for growth and enough nutrients to sustain that growth, cladophora algae can grow in massive mats over the lake bed in a process we call benthification. However, there's considerable scientific debate on how much of a role the nutrient pollution along the shoreline really plays. In the Toronto-Mississauga waterfront, we have a situation where there is potential to aggravate growth through due to the loadings of phosphorus we see. But unlike the phytoplankton that get flushed away with the currents, cladophora stay fixed in place. So this is something we need to intend to study more closely moving forward, and that we're already studying with Environment Canada. Now, what does the study area look like compared to the rest of Lake Ontario? And what is the water quality footprint on Lake Ontario? In this side, you see phosphorus and chlorophyll concentrations at our long-term monitoring sites, basically across the north side of the lake. And what you see with the three stations here on the east is that nutrient and chlorophyll conditions are pretty much indistinguishable from what you would find in the open lake. It shows that the waterfront of Toronto-Mississauga have a quantifiable footprint compared to water quality in other parts of the lake. Well, I'll finish off here with two main takeaways from this work. The first is that environmental conditions from the open Lake Ontario waters are important to shaping nearshore conditions. We have overall good water quality that has improved over time since Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement in the 1970s. This is a graph that's from one of Alice Dove's papers from Environment Canada, and it shows that basically phosphorus has decreased over time based on the various water quality agreements. And we've actually surpassed the targets that were set in 2012 for phosphorus for Lake Ontario. We're much lower than that. And the implications for that is that because these numbers are much lower in the offshore, it has an importance to flushing. So open waters from the lake are flushing waters to the near shore in the Toronto. Sorry, I have to repeat. Flushing from the open waters of the lake to near shore and of Toronto and Mississauga play a role in keeping water quality along the waterfront very good. So this hasn't always been the case, and there have been the improvements that you see on these graphs have really played a role into that. Without the improvements that have happened in the middle of the lake, conditions along the waterfront would have been much more aggravated. The second lesson is that discharges from urban rivers to the waterfront play an important role in water quality that we see along the waterfront. Our work confirmed the need for better understanding how these rivers behave and what role they play in shaping water quality along the waterfront. And what are the dynamics at play in these rivers? So this is where I pass the baton on to Lauren Barth from U of T, who will tell us about the Toronto area rivers and their features.
Great,
I think
thanks.
You're on mute. Oh, there we go.
Okay. Thanks, Nadine. Let's just... Okay, how does that look?
Looks good.
Looks good, yeah.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so thanks, Nadine. Now these 2018 lake surveys that Nadine was just talking about showed that there's a mosaic of water quality along the shoreline in the Greater Toronto area. And so the next step was really to understand what's going on in the rivers and start getting an idea of these kind of land to lake linkages. Now, the Ministry of Environment, Conservation and Parks started the Urban Rivers Project in 2018, and that's still ongoing. Now, this is the MECP tributary monitoring project that Calvin spoke of during his presentation. So we're seeing some of the results of this. Now, the data collection is actually collaboration between the MECP and also conservation authorities in the Toronto and Ganarescu regions. And so what I'm going to be presenting it on is the data up to 2020. Now, for this project, there are 12 rivers being monitored that extend along approximately 140 kilometer stretch of the northern shoreline. And this actually spans a gradient of urbanization. Now, the work that I'm presenting on, this is actually looking at more broad patterns in phosphorus loadings from urban mixed use and rural rivers, and also, you know, how these patterns vary over the year, as well as how well these patterns that we see in the rivers line up with water quality observations along the near shore of the lake. Now, these results do have implications for the growth of the nuisance alga cladophora, especially when we start thinking about the seasonality in phosphorus loadings, and also the dominant form of phosphorus that's being delivered to the lake. Now, phosphorus that ends up in the lake is comprised of two main forms. First, you have phosphorus that's dissolved in water, and then you also have phosphorus that is attached to particles. Now, the dissolved phosphorus, I've represented that by a Krispy Kreme donut, because this is in the form of phosphorus that is immediately taken up by algae and then used for growth. Now, particulate phosphorus, represented by a vegetable basket, requires much more work to access this phosphorus, since other organisms or lake processes must actually convert it to the dissolved form before it could be taken up by algae. Now, these two forms will have different fates when they are delivered to the lake by the rivers. Now, this dissolved form, this is actually going to remain suspended in the water column where algae living closer to the surface of the lake can quickly take up this phosphorus and use it for their growth. Now, this particulate phosphorus, this is actually a lot heavier. So it's going to settle to the bottom of the lake under calm conditions, and it's going to be unavailable to the algae in the water column. But it's going to be available to organisms on the body, the bottom of the lake, such as the dracinid mussels. Now, the amount of phosphorus that's ending up in rivers that will get delivered to the lake is largely dependent on three main factors. First, we have the watershed size. Now, the watershed, this is just all the area of land that captures rain and drains the water into a river. Now, as the rainwater heads to the river, it's going to pick up phosphorus and other contaminants along the way. Now, the larger this watershed, it's going to capture more water and then just provide a larger area for phosphorus to be picked up as the water heads to the river compared with a small watershed. Now, the second factor is land use patterns within the watershed. Now, within these urban suburban areas, some of the main sources of phosphorus are effluents from wastewater treatment plants. You also have lawn clippings and leaf waste within residential areas that are quite substantial. A big one is animal waste, especially dogs, as well as erosion from construction sites. Now, in rural landscapes, phosphorus sources include leaky septic systems. We have livestock farming, especially hog farming. There's also manure that's used to fertilize farmland. There's lots of soil erosion. And then we also have these natural wetlands, which are great phosphorus stores. And then you have pollen and leaves from forests. Now, the third factor that affects how much phosphorus will end up in the rivers is season. Now, during these wet periods, you're going to have these high river flows, and you're going to tend to have a greater amount of phosphorus in the river water compared to the dry periods and low river flows. Now, historically, spring has been the wettest season with the highest flows due to this springtime snowmelt combined with more frequent rainstorms. Now, there's also a second but less pronounced wet period in autumn due to more frequent rainstorms. Now, low river flows, they occur during the dry summer periods with very little rain, and also during the winter freeze up when you pretty much have ice covering the surface of the river. Now, the 12 rivers that we are monitoring, they span the north shoreline of the lake from the Credit River in the city of Mississauga to in the west to Coburg Creek in the town of Coburg in the east. And now our river water sampling stations, they're shown as yellow stars here on the map, and they're actually located pretty close to the lake. So these are the stations that Calvin was talking about that are close to the lake rather than farther up in the river. So what we're looking at really is the combined effect of all these different land use characteristics within each of these watersheds. So we can't really say what activity is causing the elevated phosphorus loadings to the lake, but just that these broad classifications of urban mixed use and rural land have specific patterns. So in general, what we see is that the Western watersheds are larger and they're more urbanized than those in the East. Now the Credit and Humber River watersheds, these are the largest of the 12 watersheds. Now the Don River is also quite large. This is actually the third biggest watershed within our study. Now the Don River and the Highland Creek watersheds, they're actually the most urban, with 56 and 63% of their surface covered with hard impervious material. So there's lots of urbanization in there, very little agriculture and forests and wetland area in these watersheds. Now, on either side of these highly urbanized watersheds, we have more of these kind of mixed use watersheds, where you have a lot more urban area closer to the lake, and then more rural land use patterns, land use characteristics in their headwaters, so farther away from the lake. And then farther east are these rural watersheds, and they're gonna have very little impervious surface cover, so there's very little urbanization, and much higher levels of agriculture, forests, and wetlands. Now, sampling river water at multiple locations throughout the year with such a high frequency required us to automate our sample collection. So at each river, we use these previously established sampling huts along the river shores to set up our instrumentation. So these are the same sampling huts that Calvin talked about in his presentation. Now these huts, they're winterized, they allow for year-round sampling. And then within each hut, there's the remotely controlled water sampler that can be programmed to collect multiple river water samples over a specified amount of time. Now, we collect the water samples using these automated samplers during pretty much all rain events that are predicted to be greater than 10 millimeters of rain during these winter freeze thaw events that are quite common now, as well as the final thaw in the spring. Now you may be wondering, how do we know when to trigger the autosamplers and sample a storm? Well, it's taken a lot of practice by our field technicians, but it's a combination of resources that they pull together to track the storm, as well as their intuition. So what, you know, they use the, they assess the upcoming weather using these weather forecasts. They can also track the storms in real time using radar. They can also monitor the sites using rain gauges from TRCA, as well as observations of water level at each of the sampling stations. Now these autosamplers, they collect multiple samples over the course of a wet weather event. Now, because of budget constraints, we need to combine these multiple samples into a single sample. In such a way that the single sample is going to represent average characteristics of that wet weather event. So we do this with a flow weighted composite sample. Now, for a flow weighted composite sample, we're going to take a subsample from each of the bottles, and this is going to be proportional to the river flow during the time that the sample was collected. Now, this single sample is going to be analyzed for a range of water quality variables, and the results of these analyses provide us with the average concentration of phosphorus over the sampling event. We then take this average concentration and they calculate the load, which just represents the total amount of phosphorus that's delivered to the lake. Now, the load, this is going to be strongly dependent on the size of the watershed. Now, with larger watersheds having greater loads than smaller watersheds, just because there's more water that gets captured and transported with a large watershed. So to account for this watershed size effect, we can standardize the load by dividing it by the area of the watershed. Now, this is called the unit area load and represents the amount of phosphorus that's exported from an area of land. Now, this metric is really useful because we can use it to compare nutrient export rates across the watersheds to help identify which watersheds have land use activities that export high rates of phosphorus to the lake. So the next couple of slides, they're going to show a series of box plots. And so box plots are really great ways to show the distribution of your data. You know, each dot in the box plot, that represents the phosphorus value from a single wet weather event for a river. Now, the box plots are neat because they are going to split your data up into four equal parts that each hold 25% of your observations. Now, this middle line here within the box, this is the median value, where you have half of the observations lying above the median and then half of the observations lying below the median. Now, all of the numbers at the top of these box plots, these are the median values. So this figure, it shows the percentage of particulate phosphorus in river water during wet weather events plotted across the rivers, right? And so this is going to give us an idea about the relative proportion of dissolved and particulate phosphorus coming into Lake Ontario. Now, higher values indicate that more particulate phosphorus is coming into Lake Ontario from these rivers. And so what we can see is that the majority of phosphorus coming into the lake during these wet weather events is in the particulate form, right? So in general, we have 77% to 94% of the phosphorus coming into the lake during these wet weather events are going to be in the particulate form rather than the dissolved form. So this is in the, actually the form, this is in the form that's not really readily accessible to the algae, but it's going to settle to the bottom of the lake and be available to the dracinid mussels. Now, these two figures, they show unit area loads of dissolved phosphorus in the top panel and particulate phosphorus in the bottom panel across these rivers. And the first thing that we actually notice is that there is a similar pattern in dissolved and particulate phosphorus unit area loadings across space, so across these rivers. We also see that phosphorus export rates, these are actually quite high from the most urban, Don, and Highland watersheds. Then we have on either side of these highly urban watersheds are the mixed-use watersheds, which we find the lowest phosphorus export rates. But then as we go further east toward these kind of rural watersheds, we find an increase in the phosphorus export rates. So what do these suggest? It suggests that both these highly urbanized and rural watersheds have land use characteristics that export large amounts of phosphorus to the lake. Now, before I talk to you about the seasonal patterns in phosphorus loads, I actually wanted to show you the seasonal patterns in river flow across our 12 monitored rivers from 2018 to 2020. Now, each colored box, that represents a season. We have spring in yellow, summer in red, autumn in light blue, and also winter in dark blue. Now, these box plots show that the highest flows occur in spring and winter, with the lowest flows in summer and autumn. Now, this recent pattern of river flow, this is different from the historical average pattern of peak flows in the spring and autumn. And so what this is suggesting is that climate change is affecting river flow in Ontario rivers, but especially during the winter season. Now, the seasonal trends in phosphorus unit area load, so these are the export rates, show that in the western highly urban rivers circled here, both dissolved and particulate phosphorus are exported at high rates year round, so across all of the seasons. Now, the mixed use and rural watersheds, what we see is that the export rates are highly dependent on the season, right? And so we see this strong U-shaped pattern that resembles how discharge changes over the year, with kind of spring and winter peaks in phosphorus export rates and the lowest in summer and autumn. So what does this really suggest to us? One of the big things is that most of the lake surveys that have been conducted by the MECP are conducted during late spring to autumn. So we're actually missing a picture of what's going on in the lake during some of the most important seasons for phosphorus input. Now, I want to show you the total loads of phosphorus so that you can see the influence of watershed size on the amount of phosphorus being transported to the lake during wet weather. Now, these mixed use Credit and Humber River watersheds exported a much lower amount of phosphorus to the lake relative to the urban watersheds. So I'm just going to go back a slide so you can actually see that. So here are the mixed use watersheds and here are the urban watersheds. However, now since the Credit River and Humber River watersheds are actually quite large, the total amount of phosphorus that they're going to end up transporting is going to be much more comparable to what we find in the highly urban rivers. Now, the Don River, which is highly urbanized and also the third largest watershed, so it actually makes sense that it's going to transport large amounts of poor quality water to the lake. Then we also have Highland Creek, which is also highly urbanized, but it's quite small. So it transports a much lower amount of phosphorus to the lake during these wet weather events compared with the Don River. So really, what did we learn from this first analysis of the tributary monitoring network data, right? So what we know is that the highly urbanized Don River and Highland Creek watersheds, they have the highest phosphorus export rates. Now, Highland Creek, it's quite small. So we see less of an impact of water quality from this river on the lake, right? However, Dawn River is quite large. And so this highly urbanized and relatively large watershed contributes the greatest amount of phosphorus to the lake across all of the different rivers. Now, the mixed use Credit and Humber River watersheds, they have pretty low phosphorus export rates, but because of their large size, they actually contribute a substantial amount of phosphorus during these wet weather events. Now, all of the patterns that we see across these rivers, they're all going to depend on the season of sampling. Now, urban rivers, they're going to have elevated levels of phosphorus year round. But phosphorus loads from the mixed use and rural rivers, they're going to be high during winter and spring. And so what this suggests is that winter is actually a lot more important than what we thought for phosphorus loads to the lake. And that we really have no idea what is going on in the lake during winter with this phosphorus and how important these winter loadings are for the organisms in the lake. Excuse me. So what do these results suggest about river phosphorus inputs potentially supporting the growth of the nuisance alga Cladophora in Lake Ontario? So phosphorus is the nutrient that limits the growth of Cladophora. Now, however, there's been studies that have found high levels of Cladophora found all across the north shoreline of the lake, even near areas with low phosphorus concentrations. Now, why is this? Right? So what's the source of phosphorus? And so we think that this could actually be due to the dracinid mussels, which are capable of converting particulate phosphorus into the form of phosphorus that algae can use. And so this large amount of particulate phosphorus that's entering Lake Ontario during winter and spring, especially from these kind of mixed use and rural rivers, that's going to get trapped in the dracinid mussel beds and create the storage of phosphorus in the nearshore. Now, Cladophora are commonly found attached to the hard shells of the dracinid mussels. So they're actually going to have first access to this dissolved phosphorus released by the mussels, potentially fueling their growth, even when the lake concentrations of phosphorus are actually quite low. And so through these lake surveys and the river monitoring network, we learned that really water quality influences along the waterfront are quite varied. Now, what we find is that water quality in the nearshore is largely governed by the background lake levels, just because there's a strong flushing that mitigates water quality impacts. But we do know that discharges and runoff to the waterfront from urban river causes a lot of variability on the shoreline. Now we know that the most urban rivers are going to deliver the poorest water quality, but this is going to be year round to the lake. And however, the highest phosphorus loads from the rivers occur during the seasons with the least amount of lake data. So we don't really actually have this holistic picture of what of the water quality patterns along the north shoreline of Lake Ontario, because we're missing a key seasonal data. Now, all of this is happening within the framework of this alternate lake ecology, right, that resulted from the dracinid mussel invasion and how they changed the environment and the effects on the nearshore water quality. And so what are some of the ongoing actions that address these issues of poor water quality in the nearshore of the lake within the Greater Toronto Area? So as part of the Toronto and Region Remedial Action Plan, there's actually several major infrastructure projects that are underway. We have the Dawn River Naturalization Project, And that actually looks to improve water quality along the Toronto waterfront by transforming the Don River closer to the lake into this healthy, more naturalized river outlet, also while improving the flood protection in the areas near the river. So in time, we should see improvements in water quality within the Toronto Harbour. We also have the Don River Central Waterfront Project, and this has the goal of eliminating these combined sewer overflows along the harbor and the Don River. And then we also have this multi-million dollar project underway to extend the Ashbridges Bay Wastewater Treatment Plant outfall from 1 to 3.5 kilometers offshore. And they're also going to add in multiple diffusers that's going to distribute the treated wastewater over a much wider area. And this is going to be beyond the nearshore region of the lake that has these strong shore parallel currents that trap nutrients and contaminants in the nearshore. So this is actually going to be distributed offshore. Now, we're left with some questions that really need further thought. But there are some ongoing activities and future work within the Western Basin with the MECP and its agency partners. So the MECP and Environment Climate Change Canada, they're exploring really what drives the growth of cladophora at their various sentinel sites, as well as these biological linkages between the dracinid mussels and the cladophora in the near shore. Now, we'll also be expanding the nearshore work that was done in 2018. So this is the nearshore surveys to really look at the shoreline from Mississauga to Hamilton. And we're also adding in 16 Mile Creek in Halton into the river monitoring network. So we are expanding toward the Hamilton area. Now, as an aside, we also have work that's using kind of existing river sampling networks. So the networks, the 12 to 13 river networks that we talked about earlier, to really explore ongoing and emerging contaminants of concern, like chloride, and also the release of toxic tire compounds. So this is the 6 ppd quinone. Now, having this network already set up really makes it quite easy to add in additional rivers and partners, ask a variety of questions, and look into loadings of different types of chemicals as they become of interest. Now, there's no shortage of work in this very dynamic and most populated area of Lake Ontario, and we really hope to continue with this work in the future. And so with that, we would like to thank a variety of people, especially all the field technicians that have gathered this data over the years. And there's been a lot of partners that have been key to setting up and continuing this whole project. So thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Nadine and Laura. That was great. We've got a couple minutes here, so and a few questions. So I'm just going to jump kind of right into those, if that's okay. So we have a question from Janet asking, is the urban source of phosphorus mainly fertilizers from lawns or for rural areas, so fertilizers for farms?
So I can't really comment on what the main source is here. But within urban areas, so we don't really have fertilizer with phosphorus being applied to urban areas. You're going to have a lot more nitrogen in there because there was the ban of phosphorus within fertilizers and detergents that really did help with lowering the amount of phosphorus that entered the lake. But this is likely more to do with potentially animals. Dogs are actually a big thing, and I was also reading about things like how we distribute our leaf clippings, right, our grass clippings, but at this point, we can't really say what it is, but the fertilizers that we typically use are higher in nitrogen and not phosphorus.
There's also the particulate load. So if you've got a lot of erosional issues, there's going to be phosphorus attached to soils that come down the riverways
So there is a lot of construction that's going on all over the place, and that's a big, big source of particulate phosphorus that's ending up. First, it goes into the air, and then it distributes, you know, on the road, and then it gets washed into the rivers.
Okay, great. Thank you. So we've got time for just one more question here. Sorry, we couldn't get to all of them tonight. But the last question here is from John. So will the recent introduction of the MECP program for stormwater through the ECA CLI program motivate municipalities to improve river discharge in Lake Ontario?
I'm not very familiar with the program that you're referring to, so I don't think I can respond to that.
Okay. Well, no problem then. In that case, maybe we'll move on just to one more here quickly then. So another question from Janet. So do hard surfaces of concrete channels and riprap for erosion control contribute to cladophore establishment more than a natural softer substrate of clay bank sites?
You want to start first, Lauren, or do you want me to?
What I know is that cladophore, they do require the hard substrates. And so if you have soft and sandy, they're not going to be able to take hold. And so that's why you find those patterns along the North Shore, where wherever there is suitable substrate, that's where the cladophore are going to establish. Then you also have the dracinin mussels, which have the hard shells. And so if the dracinin mussels get established somewhere, this will also expand the area available to the cladophora. I don't know what else you want to add in there, Nadine?
Well, having said that, a lot of the dracinin mussels will establish closer to areas that have a little bit more hard substrate. So they won't necessarily be in fully sandy areas because they need to have hold on to something as well. They do expand the surface area that's available for cladophora to hang on to. I was thinking about that question actually, Janet, and one of the things I wanted to say is it depends where and what is actually there. And with that example, I'm going to come back to say the Mimico Humber Bay waterfront, because there's a lot of stones that have been used to shore up shoreline in that area, and you do see some cladophore in that area. And some of the things that you do also see, for example, in Mimico, is that there's some storm sewers that come out into that area, and because of that, there's some freely available phosphorus in that zone that might be able to feed the cladophora, and so the cladophora will attach to that area. So you have a combination of higher nutrients, suitable substrate, clear light available for the phosphorus to grow. And especially if you have mussels in an area, then they will basically clear the water column. If you have areas where it's very turbid, you won't see as much cladophora because the cladophora need the light to grow, but they also need the phosphorus. So I hope that answers some of your question on that. I think that's, I'll leave it at that.
Okay, great. Thank you. And that's all the time that we have for tonight. So that concludes our Lake Ontario evening. So thank you so much to all of our speakers on your amazing work. And thanks as well to our speakers for answering all the questions in the chat. Or the Q&A that we were unable to get to. And thanks to all of you for joining us and participating in the Q&A. As mentioned at the beginning, a recording of this event will be posted within the next few days on the Toronto Region RAP website under the events tab. And if you do have any questions that we didn't get to tonight and you'd still like to ask them, you can reach out to me directly at don.little@trca.ca. So thanks again, everyone. Thanks again to our speakers, and have an excellent night.
Thank you.